The letters now are at the Beneke Library at Yale. And in fact, last June, they published the first volume, up until 1933, the first volume of their selected letters. And let me tell you, Connie, it's 800 pages long. And it's a big book.
Yeah.
And you can imagine, these are the selected letters, and it's only volume one. So no, they wrote back and forth. I don't know how much the mail, I tried to do some research to see when mail and how often mail was delivered when she was in Texas. And I think she got mail twice a day. And there was usually a letter from New York from Stieglitz in every mail bag. And then, yeah, she would write back.
Well, you should say, too, at that point, she is not Georgia. She is known as Patsy. Patsy who loves to go dancing.
Right.
Yeah.
She was a very popular, lively young woman and very popular among her classmates, and she liked to sing and she liked to dance. And, you know, we sort of forget when we think about her and think about how somber she became in her later years, or that was how she was portrayed, that in point of fact, she was half Irish. She was very proud of her Irish side, and she had a great sense of humor and loved to play pranks on people. And it was a whole side of her personality that I think once she became famous and then iconic that we never really got to see much of.
Yeah. She also wanted to travel, and the word Sri Lanka keeps coming in.
Oh, wow. Yeah, no, she liked to travel as she got older. At first, it was mostly she was working on her art with Stieglitz in New York. They would go to his family house in Lake George. And she was quite devoted. For the first decade they spent together, she was quite devoted. And then after that, she began to travel, mostly to the desert Southwest.
But the Sri Lanka belongs to my guest, Karen Carbo. The story in the book, because we should tell our friends that as you're writing it, it's also who am I in a way of you saying, I have been through this, it was similar, or you can make the connection.
Okay, I see what you're saying. Yes, there, one of the points that I try and make in the book, because the book is not just a biography, it's also, I mean, I like, in my mind, I always think of it sort of as biography you can use, you know. I'm interested in O'Keeffe in a way that makes sense for me and for women now in the 21st century. And one of the points I wanted to make was, in order to be able to follow your vision, find your abiding passion, even have an original thought, you really do have to sort of disconnect yourself. And O'Keeffe spoke about it as finding yourself at the tail end of the world. And in the book, I talk about how that's a lovely thought and a lovely conceit, but in point of fact, there is no tail end of the world anymore. And I talked about a trip that I took to the Maldives, which is in the Indian Ocean, south of Sri Lanka. And I was staying at a resort for a magazine article, and they had a business center. And this was on a teeny tiny island, mind you. They had a business center that had two computers, and everybody was going to the computers every day to Google things and look up song lyrics and buy shoes on Zappos.com. And, you know, we were living in over-the-water bungalows, and you could look beneath your feet on your deck and see little baby nurse sharks and little baby stingrays swimming beneath your feet outside your bungalow, and yet everybody was still on the computer. And it just shocked me that we could be in this beautiful, exotic location and still people had to go and check their email and do things like that. So that's the connection, Connie, yes.
And then there's also about Stieglitz having all these women around him.
Right. You know, I mean, Stieglitz has had many fine qualities, but he was also quite the philanderer. And one of the things that became very clear to Georgia very early in their relationship was that he liked to, quote unquote, make love with his camera, which meant photograph women in the nude, and they would inevitably become his lovers. And I believe they were together for only a few years when this started. And actually, before they were married in 1928, he had become acquainted with a young woman named Dorothy Norman. Now, Georgia O'Keeffe was already 24 years younger than Stieglitz, and Dorothy Norman was yet 10 or 12 years younger than O'Keeffe. She was younger than Stieglitz's daughter, Kitty. She was 7 years younger than Kitty. And her great appeal to him was not only did she have a boatload of money and could help underwrite his gallery, but she also completely idolized him. And Stieglitz was a man who needed to be in a relationship with a woman where he was completely idolized.
And Kitty had no use for her so-called stepmother, Georgia O'Keeffe. And Georgia, meanwhile, didn't like children.
Well, Georgia wanted her own child, but she was not a woman. She was not a carriage peeper. You know, she didn't think just because you had a baby or you were a baby that you were necessarily interesting. So I don't believe, I mean, I didn't do a lot of research about Kitty and Georgia's relationship, but I don't believe they had much of one. Although I will say, when Georgia and Alfred married in 1928, it was so that Kitty would feel better about their union, that it was supposed to be kind of a settling influence for Kitty, and Georgia married him for that reason. So,
by the way, the picture of Georgia O'Keeffe that I held up is absolutely magnificent. I know it's a picture of a woman, but the way her features and all of the part of her face come in is really glorious.
Yeah, that the picture that's in the book is actually part of his huge portrait that he took of her over between, I believe it was like 1918 to 1925. He took 500 pictures of her, 350 of which were formal sittings. Now, mind you, Connie, we think about people getting their pictures taken now. In those days, that required her to sit completely stock still for 2 to 3 minutes while these pictures were being taken. So it was quite an undertaking. And it also rendered her, and this was a great surprising fact that I found out, it also rendered her the second most photographed woman of the 20th century after Greta Garbo.
Yeah. Let us talk, too, about envy, because you have the most wonderful expression here about Otto's Law.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, Otto's Law.
But this is, again, Karen Garbo coming into the book.
Yeah. This is... you know, we talk about O'Keeffe, and it's one thing to sort of talk about her when she was struggling and she was trying to find her way in the world and she was very poor and so on and so forth. But once she becomes famous and once she becomes wealthy and once she becomes sought after, you know, when you look at what we can learn from her life, it gets a little bit different. And I sort of stepped out of the book and I talked to the reader and I basically said, you know, before you envy her, mind you, my friend Whitney Otto, who wrote a wonderful book called How to Make an American Quilt, has a great law, and basically she says, if you're going to envy somebody, you have to envy the whole life. You can't just take a part of it. You can't just take the masterpieces and the money. You also have to take the marriage and the conflicts and everything else. And this actually is a great point. She's the least envious person that I know, and it's because... you know, you have to look at everything that's going on in that person's life. You can't just envy one little part of it. So
then we come to